In the previous chapter, we studied about the uses of full stop and comma, and now let us continue the same topic with the uses of semicolon and colon and some other punctuation marks. So let us first move towards the semicolon. Semicolon represents a pause of greater importance than that shown by the comma. It means whenever we have a sentence, whenever we have a part in the sentence that is more important to quote, then we use the semicolon. And we all must be aware about the semicolon, and but very few of us are aware when we should use a semicolon. Okay, so whenever we have to show greater importance to any part of the sentence, that we can use the semicolon before that important part. For example, when I say her coat was pure, then her life serene, in this sentence her coat was pure is the first part of the sentence, and her life serene is the second part of the sentence. But we have to show, we have to give importance to the next part also. So we have used the semicolon after the first sentence. One more example. God gave her peace, her land reposed. Here also in this sentence the same thing happens. God gave her peace is the first part of the sentence, and we have to show the importance of the second part also. That's why we have used the semicolon before the second part of the sentence. Okay, one more example. Today we love what tomorrow we had. Today we seek what tomorrow we shun. Today we desire what tomorrow we fear. In the third sentence also, the third sentence is divided into three parts. Today we love what tomorrow we have, then today we seek what tomorrow we shun, then today we desire what tomorrow we fear. And before each part we have used the semicolon to show importance, to give importance to the next part. Okay, so whenever we have to give importance to any statement or to any point in the sentence, then we can use the semicolon just before that part or just before that point. Now let's move towards the other punctuation mark, that is the colon. The colon marks a still more complete pause than that expressed by the semicolon. So it is used often with a dash after it, or it can also be omitted. The dash can be omitted also. So the colon is used to introduce a question, a quotation. For example, Bacon says, "Reading makes a full man." Writing an exact man. Speaking a ready man. So in this sentence, whatever Bacon said was put in the inverted commas, and we have introduced the statement of Bacon by using a colon with the dash. Another example, another use of colon is that the colon is used before enumeration or detailed account whenever we have to show a detailed account of something, then we use the colon after that, before that account. Okay, for example, the principal parts of a verb in English are present tense, the past tense, and the past participle. Here in this sentence also, we are going to show in detail the principal part of a verb in English. That's why we have placed a colon just before the parts of a verb. One more example to show the same thing. I have three brothers who are Mohit, Rajiv, and Neeraj. So in this manner we use the colon in a sentence. One more use of colon is that the colon is used between sentences grammatically independent but closely connected in sense. For example, when I say study to acquire a habit of thinking, no study is more important. Here the sentence "study to acquire a habit of thinking" is somehow closely related, closely connected with the next part of the sentence, "no study is more important." That's why we have used the colon to show a connection between these two sentences. Okay. Now the other punctuation mark is the question mark or the interrogation mark. We are very well aware of what a question mark is, okay, and we are also aware when we have to use the question mark in the sentence. The question mark is used instead of full stop. after a direct question. Such as, have you written your exercise? One more example. If you prick us, do we not bleed? If you trickle us, do we not laugh? If you poison us, do we not die? And if you wrong us, shall we not have revenge? But the question mark is not used after an indirect question is He asked me whether I had written my exercise. This sentence is a kind of indirect question, but we have not used the question mark after it, because whenever we have a direct question, only then we use the question mark after it. But if the question is indirect, then we do not use the question mark after the sentence, but use full stop. Now let's move to towards the next punctuation mark, that is the exclamation mark. And you must have also heard about the exclamatory sentence, after which we always use exclamation mark. The exclamation mark is used after interjections and after phrases and sentences expressing sudden emotion or wish. It means whenever we have an exclamatory sentence expressing the feeling of joy, surprise and sorrow, we put the exclamation mark just after it. Such as, alas, oh dear, alas shows the feeling of sorrow, oh dear also shows the feeling of sorrow. So we have used the exclamation mark after this expression. To show surprise, we also use the exclamation mark after the sentence, like, what a terrible fish this is. This shows a sudden feeling of surprise, and to show this we have used the exclamation mark after the expression. Okay, one more example. How beautiful the rain is. When the interjection, one thing that is to be kept in mind is that when the interjection O is placed before the nominative of address, the exclamation mark, if employed at all, comes after the noun, or it may be placed at the end of the sentence. For example, O father, I hear the sound of guns. O Hamlet, speak no more. In the first sentence, O father, I hear the sound of guns, we have written father as the nominative of address. Okay, and after O father, we have placed an exclamation mark. And in the next sentence, O Hamlet, we did not use the exclamation mark after the nominative address, but we have used the exclamation mark after the sentence. So exclamation mark can be used just after O interjection and the nominative address, or it may be used at the end of the sentence containing the interjection O and the nominative address. Okay, like we did in the second sentence. The other punctuation mark is the inverted commas. And we must all be aware about inverted commas, like we have the inverted commas in the direct speech. So let's know how the inverted commas are used in the sentences. First, the inverted commas are used to enclose the exact words of a speaker or a quotation. For instance, Rajiv said to me, "Be a gentleman." Here in this sentence, whatever Rajiv said was enclosed in the inverted commas without making any change. So, "be a gentleman" is a quotation from Rajiv, and we have enclosed it with the help of the inverted commas. One more example to show this is, Gandhiji said, "Do or die." This is what Gandhiji had said, and we have enclosed it in the inverted commas. But if a quotation occurs within a quotation, it is marked by single inverted commas. For example, you might as well say, "Added the March hare that I like what I get," is the same thing as "I get what I like." This is a big sentence. You might as well say is the quotation. Okay, and within this quotation there is another quotation which is I like what I get, and another quotation within that quotation is I get what I like. And to show the another quotation within the same quotation, we have used the single inverted commas. And whenever we have to show the main quotation, then we can use the inverted commas. Another punctuation mark is the dash, and the dash is used to indicate an abrupt stop or change of thought. Such as, if my husband were alive, but why lament the past? Here in this sentence, we have two expressions. One is of wish or desire, and the another is to avoid from wishing or having any desire. The first sentence, if my husband were alive, expresses a kind of wish or desire, but then we find an abrupt or sudden change in the thought, and to mark that change we have used the dash. Then the dash is also used to resume a scattered subject. For instance, when I say friends, companions, relatives all deserted him, here in this sentence we have friends, companions and relatives as the scattered subjects. Okay, and then all deserted him is the next part of the sentence, and to show the scattered subject as a whole, we have used the punctuation mark dash. That's all for today. We will begin the same topic in the next lecture. Okay, thank you.